Welcome back. And so we are with an exclusive interview just with you guys where we can ask a lot of the questions that we didn't get a chance to while Nelson was on stage. Welcome, Nelson.
Hello, thank you.
This is Nelson Switzer, who's the Chief Sustainability Officer at Nestle Waters.
That's right.
Which is different than Nestle USA.
That's right.
Okay, which yes. I tweeted incorrectly.
Well, that's okay.
So one of the questions that we got online that we didn't get a chance to talk about via Twitter was, what were the key challenges that led to the development of the siting framework for water?
Right.
So let's back up and say, okay, what was the, you guys have done a number of different siting frameworks, right? Or is this, and then there's like some sort of community engagement aspect within siting water. So give me a broad overview of what that framework does.
Right. Okay. So previous iterations you brought up first.
Yeah.
So yes, in 2010, 2011, we developed the first, I would say, iteration. So formalizing this process. And when we did that, we did it in partnership with Business for Responsibility and a number of other groups. And really it gave us that first opportunity to sort of take apart what we had been doing for quite some time.
Right.
And very successfully, quite frankly, and see, is there a way we could do it better? How could we do it better? And so we used that process. And again, for a couple of years, it really was working very nicely. But we saw things change very quickly, quite frankly. One of the things that we saw change was, you know, the level of campaign activity. We saw local communities confused. The internet is an incredible beast. But at the same time, there's a tremendous amount of misinformation up there. And it gives people an opportunity to share misinformation. So communities that, you know, may have invited us in may do a Google search and find that there is somebody who objected to us in another community a world away.
Right.
And so that can start to influence and cement their thinking. And if that happens before we have actually had a chance to have a conversation, find out what's important to them, it's more difficult to have that conversation and move it forward. So, you know, we sort of recognize that both what exists online, the perspective and opinions of others, and what it is we needed to do to sort of to turn that around. So when we looked at that framework, we really pulled it apart. And we took first a look at where we were really, really good, where we were really, really weak, and everything in between.
Right.
And here's what I knew, and here's what I saw first. First of all, I saw that we had an exceptional process. I mean, what we are so good at, and I think better than anybody, is on the science. Ensuring the sustainability of the source is paramount. And we're exceptional at that. Engaging with people one-on-one, we are really, really, and have been really, really good at that. Developing long-term, deep relationships has also been something I think that's been a talent for us.
Yeah.
But where we recognize perhaps we needed to improve.
Yes. The mistakes, the lessons learned.
Yeah,
right.
For sure. Mistakes. Right. And I'm happy to talk about mistakes themselves, but I think it's prioritizing science over relationships. So while if you can think about, you know, this continuum, we've got great science and great engagement, but they were parallel paths rather than part of each other's process.
Right.
And so what we've done is we've taken this process apart and we've put it back together with that community relationship need right at the center. Because what we realized, and I think I said this up on stage, is that I think the way it was regarded, and maybe still is regarded, is that we come into a community and develop a water resource.
Right.
But what we're trying to do, and I think what we're doing much better now, is we are helping the community develop their resource on a set of shared terms. You know, and one of the ways we do that is by making sure we engage them. We ask them questions. We let them ask us questions. I shouldn't say let. They ask us questions, and we do that continually. So it's not a one-time dialogue. It's a continuous conversation. I mean, I could certainly point out mistakes that we have made. I mean, there's some interesting ones. I always, of course, prefer to talk about successes. But if people want to know about, you know, a specific example, I'm happy to roll one out.
Well, I mean, I think, you know, you had tweeted previously about Cape Town, day zero.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we're in Arizona. Water's scarce here as well. You see lots of green lawns. Mm. You have a bottling plant. I mean, there are a number of things. But I know you don't necessarily operate directly in Cape Town.
Yeah, no.
But the situation, as many of you may know, is obviously they're running out of water. And I think they estimate April.
April 1st is when they're saying it's going to be the drop date.
Right. So water rationing, nothing from the tap. I mean, they're predicting that it's like a war.
Yeah.
Right. And so I guess the question is, you know, obviously an extreme cautionary tale, but clearly on I mean, Karachi, Pakistan. You're seeing it in Kentucky. You're obviously
we're not talking
Flint.
About Syria. I mean,
I know,
you know,
you're
like
talking,
that.
Yeah.
That is a civil war because there wasn't
several
enough
million.
Water for them to grow their agricultural crops and feed people. So through starvation, I mean, this is happening in too many places.
Yeah.
And I think the reason that it's happening is, I mean, this is a systemic failure.
Yeah.
Paired and coupled against the challenges of climate change and the ravages of climate change, this volatility in the system that we cannot predict. So where is water going to be and when? We can't predict that anymore.
Right.
You know, when I was in school and I studied engineering for a while, I remember the tables at the back of the books, right? That always said, you know, here's your 10-year flood event. Here's your 100-year
right.
flood event.
That's not even
you can't rely
realistic
on that
anymore. Yeah.
So we've got infrastructure that has been built that relies on those old models, but they don't work anymore.
Right.
So the challenge is that we have governments who I think, you know, either they don't have enough financial resources or the political clout or will, they don't feel they have the support of the community to go ahead and take the long-term actions that are necessary. And I, you know, I'm very scared. I said, I think actually in one of my tweets I had said that we should look at Cape Town as the canary in the coal mine.
Yeah.
And I kind of realized after I tweeted that, that's not right.
No.
And the reason it's not right is because that's not the first.
There have been so many canaries.
There have.
So this is really just the extreme of like a several million person
Four million
city.
People.
Right. Yeah. So clearly this is, you know, a harbinger. At the same time, there's a CEO water mandate for water. There's a number of different private sector actions. So what is Nestle Waters doing to maybe educate and kind of, I mean, besides the citing community engagement, which is significant,
sure, yeah.
Which you, I assume,
but,
because
but to
it's
be
public,
fair,
yeah.
That's, yeah, that's a process for helping bring transparency to
right.
what it is that we're doing for when we're citing new spring sources. I think where I hear you going, and maybe I should let you ask the question, but I think where I hear you going is what is it that we're doing when it comes to all of these other very significant issues, whether it's
right.
Flint
right.
or whether it's California
right.
or closer to home and in Cape Town. So, you know, it's such a long list, or quite honestly, it's so long.
What's a
so,
real important one? We have to wrap
okay.
up really soon, but
I
just kind of concisely.
I would probably bring up the California Water Action Collaborative. That's one of my favorites.
Okay.
So it's an organization that we helped found in California when the governor released the California Water Action Plan.
Right.
That was really pushed on all the residents of California, but there was nothing that was asked of the businesses. And we sort of were sitting around this table saying, well, hold on a second, why are the businesses not being asked to do their part? So we sat down with a group, Pacific Institute,
right.
and a number of others, Miller Coors, and we said, well, what can we do? So we sat down and we came up with this agreement. Let's form our own collaborative
right.
where we're going to bring not-for-profits who have solutions
right.
together with corporations who have some capacity.
Right.
And see if we can come up with a series of solutions and ideas together. And so we have. So we now have, I think, 40 members or so that get together and we talk about action. Our plan is all about what it is that we're going to do to take action. Then we take action. So
right.
we've got a project, for example, in the American River headwaters with the Nature Conservancy,
right.
where we are working to help increase the amount of surface water flow in the American River, which is an enormous...
Wow, yeah.
I mean, it's really about restoring and renewing
right.
And,
right.
and reinventing.
So how can people learn more or get their organizations if they're working for companies that are water intensive? What can they do?
Well, so I think there's a few things. First of all, I would say if you're in a corporation and you're water intensive, look at the Alliance for Water Stewardship Standard.
Okay.
It is the standard that any company that wants to advance their water stewardship commitment should be considering. Number two, they need to look at their local water context and not treat water as a global issue.
Yeah.
It's not a global issue. It's
yeah.
a very local issue. And number three, I would say look at organizations like the CEO Water Mandate
okay.
And examples like the California Water Action Collaborative
right.
for what it is you can become a part of
yep.
and figure out it's, I guess I would say, the time for small moves is kind of over.
Yeah.
Think about the big move you need to make.
Right. The big leverage points.
Yeah.
I think that's a good way to end it.
Sure.
Those are great resources. Thank you, Nelson.
Yeah, no, my pleasure.
And that's a wrap for the beginning of day two. Stay tuned. We'll be back at 3:45 Mountain Time, back with more plenaries. But right now, we're going to take a break. See you soon.